time here. If you have something to say at the foot of a meeting, please sign up on the sheet. If you have something to say and you don't sign up, you still will be allowed to speak. After all, this is America, and you have that privilege to do that. We do have a process in which we do the speaking, and I will fill you in on that later on. It is July 1st, 2014, the year is going by quickly, and I want to introduce everyone for the Randy Pace with the Family Worship Center. Please will lead us in a prayer, and then the pledge to the flag. Let's stand.
In Jesus' name, I bless this meeting. I speak wisdom and understanding to our leaders. I pray for our leaders. I pray for our country. Lord, I thank you that we're going to celebrate a birthday here for our country in just a few days. And I just thank you for the freedoms that we have here, for the fact that we have the ability to elect our government, to choose our leaders, and to change those leaders without having war and insurrection. I thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that you've blessed us with corporately as a nation and individually for all of our freedoms and for the provisions that you have blessed us with. I bless this meeting in Jesus' name.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Brother Randy, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for following me.
Agendas are on the back bench if you need one, and we're going to move on to number four, presentation and approval of bills. Magistrates, in your packet are the bills as passed from the judge executive's office. If there are any questions, let us know. If not, action is requested.
I make a motion to the President on June 17th as stated.
I Thank you, Madam Chair, Mr. Tracy.
I'm sorry.
Oh, yes.
We need to make a correction on this coverage, so what the disbursement is.
Yes, the total is $54.97 that needs to be added.
And that was actually disbursed.
That was on the 17th on the...
Yes. Right, yeah.
Any questions concerning this change? Do we have a motion and second?
I have a motion, yes.
We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion concerning the amendment to the minutes? Hearing none, Ms. Brandon, you call the roll.
Ms. Ashcroft?
Yes.
Mr. Burnett?
Yes.
Ms. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Ms. Roberts?
Yes.
And now, action requested on the June 25th minutes.
Round it over to I.
Long as they done it.
I have made a motion that we accept the minutes on June 25th. That's the way they're stated.
We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussions concerning the June 25th minutes? And Ms. Brandon, you may call the roll.
Ms. Ashcroft?
Yes.
Mr. Burnett?
Yes.
Ms. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Ms. Roberts?
Yes.
Next, we're on presentations, number six on the agenda. We have Kevin Moody, our county clerk, to provide us with a budget discussion. Good morning, Kevin.
Good morning, everybody. This one's pretty short and sweet to the point. I think it's the condition report, it's the name where it shows the percentage of budget line item used. Our health insurance line has gone over by about $3,500. There's been a movement of some money into that line to cover that. And it basically goes back to the beginning of your all's budget cycle to the timing of the bill coming in from the insurance company and being paid after the end of your all's budget cycle. So it effectively dropped a 13th month of billing inside of the 12-month cycle, which we had buffer built into this line item. And I wanted you all to be aware, just so you understood why and how this would happen. The potential is there on a year-by-year basis for this to happen. We added $4,000 to this line item in the budget that you all approved recently. We believe that that will be enough cover this in the future. So primarily, I just want you all to be aware of it, and that's all I have.
Thank you, Kevin. Next on our agenda, we have presentations for two folks who are near dear to my heart because of being in the school system. One I've worked with, we'll get to Tracy in just a minute. Those of you who are here to honor Barbara Elliott, come on up if you'd like to. And we want to honor Ms. Barbara Elliott today. Magistrates, if you want to join me or anyone in this facility, this is what members are invited to join me.
Thank you.
This is Ms. Donna Miller. How do you like them here?
Just Donna's okay.
Just Donna's okay. Donna is the leader of our Fulton County Community College. She is our executive director over there. And I guess you ought to call you president.
No. I don't do that.
But Donna is going to say a few words about Ms. Barbara Elliott.
Thank you, Judge. And thank you, members of this court, for allowing us to be here today. I just want to tell a brief little story about Ms. Elliott. Barbara began her teaching career at Shepherdsville High School in January 1968, where she taught there for 2.5 years. She transferred to the new Bullitt Central High School, where she taught English, drama, speech, and was a debate coach. Her debate teams traveled frequently, reaching national finals on many occasions. She was also instrumental in securing funding for the Bullitt Central Auditorium, where the drama team performed numerous plays and musicals under her direction. She served not only as a teacher, but as assistant principal, as well as the principal of Bullitt Central, from where she retired in 1997. As an active member of First Baptist Church of Shepherdsville, Barbara served as deacon, adult Bible study teacher, and on the missions committee. She was previously the drama coordinator for the church and assisted weekly with the Dear to Care food distribution, as well as a member of the sanctuary choir and the personnel committee. Instrumental in working with the Kentucky Refugee Ministry and First Baptist to sponsor a Cameron family from Myanmar, 5 years later, she's still involved with this family, assisting them in school responsibilities, as well as moving them to purchase. So now I want to talk about Barbara's relationship with our college. In 2003, First Baptist began a ministry service at the Bullitt County Detention Center, working with adult education as GED instructors. Barbara was one of the original gang of three, to go into the detention center and be involved with this ministry. She recently retired from this position as a volunteer instructor after serving for 11 years. And she's truly been a productive citizen of Bullitt County and has dedicated her life to improving the circumstances of others through education. So while she was working there for 11 years, I'm thinking a lot about this, Barbara, and looking back over what that means to get up every day and go in year after year as a volunteer to help people in need. And it reminded me that, there you have a lot of inmates. A lot of incarcerated people, those are your students. And I was thinking about the prophet Zechariah and how he referred to prisoners too. And I'm going to suggest today that Barbara Elliott is a prisoner of hope. And that in serving in that position at that institution, she was truly a prisoner of hope for those inmates who were looking for better opportunities and more opportunities for work and to become a productive citizen. It takes a special person who has a special heart to go do that day after day, year after year. And it takes a special person with a special heart to provide hope in these kinds of circumstances. So, countless number of inmates have received their GED and their transition to a better life for themselves and their families because of Ms. Barbara Elliott. And because of that, I'd like to present you with this small token, Ms. Elliott. I hope that you remember your work with us, and it says, for a lifetime of changing lives. We love you and we wish you well.
Thank you.
And Barbara, one of the things I could do as a judge executive is officially proclaim certain days People's Days. Well, guess what? Today is your day. And here we go. You're going to hear some things that Donna just talked about. But that's good.
That way you can check to see if that's correct.
Proclamation of Melanie J. Roberts, Bullitt County Judge Executive. Whereas Barbara Elliott began her teaching career at Shepherdsville High School in January of 1968, where she taught for 2.5 years. She transferred to the new Bullitt Central High School, where she taught English, drama, speech, and was the debate coach. Her debate teams traveled frequently, reaching national finals on many occasions. Also, she was instrumental in securing funding for the Bullock Central Auditorium, where the drama team performed numerous plays and musicals under her direction. And whereas Barbara Elliott served not only as teacher, but as assistant principal and principal of Bullock Central High School until she retired in 1997. And whereas Barbara Elliott is an active member of the First Baptist Church of Shepherdsville, where she has served as deacon, adult Bible study teacher, and on the missions committee. She previously was drama coordinator for the church, assistant weekly with the Dare to Care food distribution program, and is a member of the sanctuary choir and personnel committee. And whereas Barbara Elliott was instrumental in working with Kentucky Refugee Ministry to sponsor a
Karen
family from Myanmar.
Burma.
5 years later, she is still involved with the family, assisting them in school responsibilities and the purchase of a new home. Whereas Barbara Elliott was one of the three original people involved with the ministry at the Bullock County Detention Center, working with adult education as a GED instructor. Barbara retired from being a volunteer instructor after 11 years. She has truly been a productive citizen of Bullock County and has dedicated her life to improving the circumstances of others through education. She will be missed dearly. Now, therefore, I, Melanie J. Roberts, Bullock County Judge Executive of the Commonwealth of Kentucky, do hereby proclaim July 1st, 2014 to be Barbara Elliott Day. And let's
Barbara got me to realize realized that hammering is not my spiritual gift. We were working on a set for the drama church several years ago, and I was trying to help in a manly way, to help nail something together. And she took that hammer out of my head and said, "Give me that hammer, that is not your spiritual gift." But we did work well together for many years, and I appreciate her so much.
Now they bring retired teachers in the head.
And I think Teresa deserves a round of applause.
I donated 496 hours in the year 2013. Not work. On domestic violence awareness and prevention.
And we thank you very much for that. And I have a certificate for you. This says certificate of recognition for your dedication to the citizens of this county and as Kentucky Retired Teachers Association Volunteer of the Year, we honor Teresa Byerly on behalf of a thankful Bullitt County. Please accept our congratulations on being chosen as Volunteer of the Year and best wishes for the future.
Thank you. I have one thing to say, and I always say when I end this, I do this because my sister was murdered by her husband 4 years ago. We are the rememberers, the ones left behind.
Would you like to say anything to Teresa? Yes,
I just want to say, I was director of the Retired Teachers Association for years, and I'm trying to come over to volunteers. Teresa is an example of the kind of person, Barbara, that needed to go ahead serving the community, and we appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Hatfield. Mr. Hatfield was our superintendent of the Bullitt St. Paul School System You were the superintendent for 21 years?
Yes, ma'am.
During the years of, you know,
66 to 87.
And he hired me, so.
So thank you, and you're Barbara too. Well, Mr. Hatfield, thank you for being here, because you know how important education is to me. I have my grandmother, my aunt, my mother, and I thank you for the service you have provided. Let's give Teresa another round.
Says that Bullitt County is a certified, recognized as a storm-ready county. I would like to present this morning to the Bullitt County Fiscal Court and also to the people of Bullitt County. This is your certificate. So this is for all peoples of Bullitt County. And with that, I'll give that to the county judge. If anybody has any questions about storm rating, you can go on the internet and just type in storm rating. And you can read there and see what the details is as far as the length of process of that. And always feel free to call Bullitt County Emergency Management. We're there to help you. That's our goal, is to provide services to you. And I'll be honest with you, if we do not know the answer, we'll find it for you. We'll let you know. But we just don't know. We'll try to find the answer for you. And our goal is to make Bullitt County a safer county during disasters and severe weather preparedness, and to be there for you in times of need. So thank you for allowing me the time this morning. I appreciate it. And like I say, we're here if you need us. Thank you.
I'll second.
motion and a second. Any questions or discussion concerning the motion?
Is it to approve or pass? We're passing the date or we're approving?
You want to go ahead and read the motion.
The motion is to approve zoning ordinance number 14-08.
And there are no questions or discussion concerning the motion, so Ms. Brand, you may call the roll.
Ms. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Rockwell?
Yes.
Mr. Strange, thanks for being here today. And go ahead, Ms. Parker.
Our next topic is 2014-06. The applicant is Newsom Properties LLC. Excuse me, the planning commission purchased the case on May 8th, 2014. They recommended approval because this property does join other residential property in East Complex Plan for the area.
Ordinance number 14-08, an ordinance changing the zoning from agricultural to R1 residential. The property in question is 2.5 acres more or less, located at 557 Miller Lane in an unincorporated area of the county. Be ordained by the fiscal court of the county of Bullitt, Colleton, Kentucky. In summary, number one sets forth the above property located in the unincorporated area of Bullitt County, and more particularly described in the minutes and records of the planning commission, docket number 2014-Z06, is hereby changed from agricultural to R1 residential. Given first reading at the regular meeting of the fiscal court of Bullitt County, Kentucky on the 17th day of June 2014, and to be set for the second reading at the regular meeting of Bullitt County Fiscal Court on the first day of July 2014.
Thank you, County Attorney. Action requested. I do think we have Joe Mills.
Yes, ma'am.
Representing this property. If there are any questions, post a public hearing to place at the first. Thank you, Joe, for being here.
Absolutely.
Action is requested, please.
Joe, what area is that county? Is that in the county?
It's located off 480. That would be going towards Nelson County. If I'm not mistaken, if you're going towards Nelson, it's on the left of the side of 480.
Okay. I'd like to motion to approve the assistant parking lot.
Thank you, Magistrates. We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion on the motion? Ms. Brandon, you may call the roll.
Ms. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Crawford?
Yes.
Mr. Carey?
Okay. Our next case is that 2014-07. Michael Biden was applicant. The planning commission heard this case on May 8th, 2014. They recommended approval. The properties are zoned agricultural non-conforming and do not comply with the regulations of 10 acres plus to remain agricultural. And this property does adjoin other residential property, and this would bring it into compliance with the zoning regulations.
Ordinance number 14-09, an ordinance changing the zoning from agricultural to R1 residential. The property in question is 12.65 acres, more or less, located at 960 K Holland Road and 870 K Holland Road in an unincorporated area of the county. Be ordained by the fiscal court of the county of Bullitt, Commonwealth of Kentucky. In summary, number one sets forth the above property located in the unincorporated area of Bullitt County, and more particularly described in the minutes and records of the planning commission in docket number 2014-07, is hereby changed from agricultural to R1 residential. Given the first reading at the regular meeting of the fiscal court of Bullitt County, Kentucky on the 17th day of June 2014, and being on today for the second reading as a regular meeting of the Bullitt County Fiscal Court on the first day of July 2014.
Thank you, County Attorney. And Joe, are you here representing this property?
Yes, ma'am.
Are there any questions from the magistrates to Mr. Mills?
Where is this located, Mr. Mills?
Ma'am, this is off Cave Hollow Road. Cave Hollow Road, I guess the Claremont area is what that would be. And this is some property that, as Sam mentioned, is ag non-conforming. This is a gentleman who owns all of it, and he wants to make it residential so that we could, in the future, either gift or sell some of his property to his family members. There's already a couple houses on the property, but this is really just an attempt to fix a problem and also so that he could gift or sell the property to family members later. But it's off an old road, Cape Hall Road, out in the Claremont area. If I'm not mistaken, it gets pretty close to Jim Beam.
Yes.
And it's, I think it's zoned currently light and non-conforming, but and there is some industrial out there also, but the road is so bad. I mean, really the only thing that's being used for is residential, in my view.
Thank you.
Action is requested.
This is two properties, each one of them being less than correct.
Yes, this was divided into tracts several years ago, and now they want to sell off possibly or give some property to family members. So in order to bring it into compliance, they're asking to rezone the whole acreage.
No, I was just going to ask.
Let me intercede at this point. We had a hearing at the last meeting. If you'd like Ms. Haven to read you the report from the Planning and Zoning Commission, again, she can do that. But we should not be taking additional testimony or statements at this time.
I didn't know what you were saying.
I'll make a motion.
I'll second that motion.
We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion? Go ahead and read the motion.
The motion will be to approve zoning ordinance
2-09. And any questions or discussion on the motion? Ms. Brandon, you may call the roll.
Ms. Ashcroft?
Yes.
Mr. Hyde?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Rock?
Yes. Thank you, Joel. Thank you, Director Van. Director Sauer, see your call. Go ahead, Deputy Judge.
Judge, he didn't hear that, it's not good enough. If he did want me to ask the court if you all remember on the June 17th meeting, we all have the 392,000 for Applegate Lane, or Applegate Run. He thought at that time that we weren't going to be able to be started till the fall, but he said that the money is coming in slower than he anticipated from the state.
EMS starting salary for
I make a motion that we hire these people that Director Phillips has just recommended at the salary that has been stated. Do I hear a second?
I'll second the motion.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion? Ms. Brandon, you may call the roll.
Ms. Ashcroft?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Blackstock?
Yes.
Ms. Roberts?
Yes.
Thank you. That is all.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Director Phillips. Captain Judge, anything you can direct for that? Director Hawkins?
Mr. Hatfield is having fun in California. He called us to tell us.
Is that your report, Director Hawkins?
That's my report, Mr. Hatfield. He's had a good time in California.
Thank you, Director Hawkins, for that report. Director Miller, will you give me a Director? Moving on to the next page, or on the other side of the table. Under old business, number one, action is requested on Davis Computer Repair Contract. Did Mark Davis contact you all to explain what happened?
Yes, the county attorney was consulted and there were two questions that she needed to answer.
I have another view of the judge's evidence.
It's exactly true. It's exactly the same except for the house. It's just the amount of computers and the house. That's the matter.
The deputy judge and I spoke to Mark Davis about this issue. And after speaking with him, I was comfortable with the situation. And I just don't think he understood our process. Government process is much different from private business. We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion? Ms. Brandon, you may call the roll.
Ms. Ashcroft?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Blackstock?
Yes.
Ms. Roberts?
Yes.
Number one, under new business, this is the first reading of Ordinance 14-11, Sunday Alcohol Sales Ordinance. And County Attorney, would you do the reading and let us pick out the one that you want? So you don't have to read.
Well, Judge, what you have is the same. One's the summary and one's the full reading.
Okay.
You don't have a choice. That's where I guess our confusion had come from. Our understanding was that you all wanted to, from the, I forget which fiscal court meeting it was, but it was sometime in April 1st of May, that you all wanted one drafted to open up alcohol sales across the county, period. And that's what I had requested, and everybody kind of looked at me and shook their head, but nobody gave explicit direction. So that's what the summary page, or the same ordinance, if you notice the 1411, one's just in full, and one's in summary. That's what you have in front of you. And no one's called me to tell me any different. And that's why I have kept passing this to make sure that's what you all wanted, and I don't know whether it is or isn't.
And the one, just so that we're all on the same page, no pun intended. County Attorney, the ordinance that I have, the summary, number one.
Is a 14-11 at the top.
Yeah, that's it.
They're both 14-11. One is the summary, one is the full. I think at the day that we presented those, I had brought down, I think it was four different copies, because I brought down what you all, we had looked at a year prior in 2013, because you're amending the 2013. And then you all asked for a new amendment, but I was never really here, what you wanted that to be. So I prepared it based upon you all wanted countywide alcohol sales period to end. And of course, we have the cities to decide different except for the city of London Junction.
Well, I prefer ordinance number 14-11, if that's okay with the magistrates.
I'll say that.
I'm saying I prefer.
I can read it, and we'll have the first reading if you want to do that.
I suggest the county attorney read 14-11. It is the first reading, and
yes.
Yeah, that's what I'm hearing.
Yeah, your public hearing means an acting. Ordinance 14-11 and ordinance amending ordinances 11-07 and 13-25 and relating to authorizing the sale of malt beverages, wine, and distilled spirits by the drink and package, the sampling of wine at any licensed Kentucky small farm winery, and the sampling of distilled spirits at any licensed Kentucky distillery on Sundays in Bullitt County, Kentucky, be ordained by the fiscal court of the county of Bullitt, Colleton, Kentucky, in summary. Number one sets forth that the sale by the drink and by the package and the giving of complimentary samples of distilled spirits, wines, and malt beverages may occur in Bullitt County on Monday through Saturday, limited only by the Kentucky Revised Statute or regulation of the Department of Alcoholic Beverage Control, and on Sundays between the hours of 12 p.m. and 6 p.m. Number two sets forth that if any provision of this ordinance is deemed unconstitutional or invalid for any reason by a court of competent jurisdiction, that such provisions be deemed a separate provision and such shall not affect the validity of the remaining provisions of this ordinance. Number three sets forth that all inconsistent ordinances are hereby repealed. Given the first reading at the regular meeting of the fiscal court of Bullitt County, Kentucky on the first day of July 2014, and set for a second reading at a regular meeting of the Bullitt County Fiscal Court on the 15th day of July, 2014.
Thank you, County Attorney. And the second reading will be July the 15th, and that is when we will have the public hearing on this ordinance, 14-11. All right, number four. Frank Memorial and our Great Board of Trustees. Her term to expire on July 1st, 2018.
I make a motion to reappoint trustee Amy to the board.
Okay.
I make a motion.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Treasurer. We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion on the reappointment of Joyce Manning? Ms. Brandon, can I call her?
Ms. Ashcroft?
Yes.
Mr. Hurd?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Ms. Roberts?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you, Madam Treasurer. Number five, I make a motion to reappoint Martha Underwood to the Ridgeway Memorial Library Board of Trustees. Term to expire on July 1st, 2018. Do I hear a second to my motion? Thank you, Magistrate. We have a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion? Ms. Brandon, may I call the roll?
Ms. Ashcroft?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Ms. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Ms. Roberts?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you, Magistrate. Now we have an addendum. So under new business number six, action is requested on resolution 14-10, changing the speed limit to 20 miles per hour on Beach Valley Court.
I
meeting.
Motion to adjourn.
Well, I do want to let you know that General Allen did say that if we voted to not do this building, that we should be able to do that.
Let's get in line.
Having heard that we could pass another motion, there's one I want to stand.
That's a few of those, say your last two points.
Well, I feel like they had to dismiss the room with it, like, on sideways with what was going on with the water and all that, people was out. But since it did, then I feel like this is responsibility of this board, thank you.
You mean from the commissary account, or on the detention center? The detention center is a account, not a commissary. All the other accounts are private.
Well, I'm not sure how they should pay it.
Would that be possible, General?
That's not possible, it's a sure order, we've got there, like any other board, or like any anybody else, which is on HIP. Yes, it was possible, yes, it was possible. He knew it was possible before he asked me the question, and I did what was necessary to get it done. The court order stands, I have no other means of paying for it to, but to this court. So, I mean, if you all choose not to pay it, then...
Well, Judge, first was one day decided she was indigent, and then in some other papers that he filed, or put out there, showed that she's paid $200 for this thing, and small money for this thing, more money for this thing. Well, she's got that kind of money, she wasn't indigent.
Well, I'm not liberty to say anything on that. I have nothing in that.
Just for folks, why used to pay on it.
And if that's what you all choose, that's y'all's choice. But Mr. Allen is saying that, you know, it would, that he's going to collections on it, which would be a black eye for Floyd County, but that's y'all's choice. Then that's y'all's choice.
I don't want to speak for Mr. Allen. I have no idea what the definition of foreign collections are. But I would assume you would contact the county attorney. I have received no contact from Harden County. And that turns off.
Okay.
Could we just lay this over and put it in a full court next meeting? Let's table this. I'll make a motion to table this until the next meeting we can have a full court.
Okay, motion's on the floor. Do we have your second? I'll say one. Thank you. We have a motion and a section. Ms. Brandon, read the motion.
Why, Mr. President?
Sure.
Would you like the motion to approve that we would judge with my friend?
I think that is the motion.
Well, the motion is to table discussion on the part of the...
That would be fine.
Yes.
I
have a second to our motion?
Yes.
Any questions or discussion concerning the motion? Ms. Brandon, you may call the roll.
Ms. Axelrod?
Yes.
Mr. Hunt?
Yes.
Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Mr. Brown?
Yes. We do have another issue in our way of the Hillview situation. The Hillview situation.
I know the last meeting, before we instructed us to advise our project's office to send a letter to the city of Hillview requesting a monthly $3,000, remember the exact figure, the last payment that was sent to them. The more that we looked into this, we realized that there were two payments actually made after the July resolution, July 2012 resolution.
One payment was in the amount of $31,000, and that's an estimate. And the other payment was in the amount of $93,000.
Those were the only two payments that went to them after they adopted their resolution. So our question was, instead of requesting the $93,000, would you prefer us to go ahead and request the total amount of the $125,000?
Almost $125,000. The exact amount is $124,956.39.
The way that we see that is those are the only two payments that we feel with certainty that would be due back to us. The payments that were made prior to that, even though there wasn't an agreement in place, everything was still being followed as if it was.
I would suggest going for the $124,956.39. You need me to put that in?
Yes.
I make a motion to go for $124,956.39 in the amount of the last two checks from State Hillview.
Thank you, Willie. We have a motion and a second on the floor. So I have Bridget read the motion.
The motion is to request the amount of $124,956.39 from the insurance tax premium overpayment to the city of Hillview. Request the funds.
Finish that.
Sorry. I love that one.
That's all right.
The motion is to request the funds back in the amount of $124,956.39 for the insurance tax premium overpayment to the city.
Any questions or discussion on the motion? And I do have two hands up. This is question and answer session. Mike is in the first year. Mike, go ahead and express your question.
Yes, is this in lieu of the $273,000 you all were talking about last week?
Okay, Mike, this is concerning the $273,000 that we were talking about last week.
Yes.
And we haven't come up with this figure, but with the deputy judge's research into the situation, we have figured out, like we said, two payments were made, total of $124 change, and okay. We want to ask for that.
So this, the $124 is the total?
Correct.
Okay.
That we want to ask for.
Yes.
From the city of Hillview.
Yes.
Thank you. You're welcome, Mike. Yes, Gary.
The answer, Mike. Yes, my question.
Yes. You're very welcome. Yes, Sandy.
How did this happen?
Oh, I will have to turn that over to the treasurer.
How did that happen that, you know, that much money going notice for so long?
I didn't know the contract had expired. I don't think the judge's office had been here. It was put in for the budget and we paid it as if the contract was still going on. And we questioned it during the preparation of the 14-15 budget.
Oh,
Sandy, go ahead and ask a follow-up question. Well, you've got a chance for a follow-up question, and then Treasurer can answer that.
Well, I would ask who's responsible for having that knowledge and who's responsible for not, you know, relaying that knowledge to the people that should know that. I mean, how did that happen?
And I'll let the Treasurer follow up and answer.
I don't keep up with contracts that I don't have contracts in the Treasurer's office.
Well, Sandy, we've already done our, we've done the live report. But Sandy, we are more than happy, I'm sure the Treasurer would be more than happy to sit down with you so you can ask these questions to her.
But does anybody in this courtroom know who's responsible for knowing that? Because I don't know who to ask.
Well, I kind of defer to the Treasurer. So, yeah, I have to defer to the Treasurer because it's written by the Treasurer's office.
But what's the contract? What she's asking is, who's in charge of the contract? Who has got to put the, when it, it's no longer good?
Fiscal court is in charge of knowing what contracts are there and what contracts are not there.
Let's rephrase it. Absolutely, it's the county judge's office. Am I correct? Don't you have a contract?
But it takes the fiscal court to pass it. Now, okay. Folks.
That was DD. That was good for God, okay?
I am here to answer questions at any time. We've got hands up. This is a political season. I'm very aware this is a political season.
But don't change it.
There are
lawyers. You have that option.
We see that with the award ceremony.
Well, excuse me, we've got to have the control in the courtroom. So let's do this. Ms. Higgins, I'm sure the Treasurer would be happy to meet with you concerning the situation. The Deputy Judge can chime in and let you all know that the Fiscal Court approves contracts. No invoices were submitted. Deputy Judge, you want to discuss that situation?
That's true. Those check, when the judge's office submits invoices for payment to Treasurer, or submits invoices for payment, we have to have an invoice for each payment. The taxes, the insurance tax premiums are written through the Treasurer's office. She has a formula that she uses prepare those numbers. Is that correct? You take either $100,000 or the percentage, which is greater.
Originally, it's $25,000 a quarter or 4%, whichever is greater. All those reports are made. They're up in my office, just like child support invoices that are never sent to your office for signature. I don't have those invoices that go down on a 5-week basis either.
You do have a court order. If we bring in something else.
Absolutely.
Child support.
I can do that in this court.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, there's a difference.
Absolutely. Well, to my knowledge, I was under a contract.
Go ahead, Deputy Judge. Well, my question is, so do we pay bills without the invoices?
No. There's a standing order that we sign work to produce each year for certain invoices and bills to be paid without invoice. They're awesome. But typically, 99% of them are not.
Okay, so this was paid without an invoice, and that's perfectly okay.
I have the reports upstairs.
I don't know if our insurance tax premiums are part of that standing order to be paid without.
So, again, it's okay to pay this without an invoice. Correct.
Who was going to invoice the judge? I have the information. Of the income, of the incoming amount of insurance premium to pay Hillary.
So again, it's okay.
I have the information upstairs.
Okay, so it's okay, it was okay to pay this bill without an invoice.
And I have the invoice upstairs.
Okay, so.
So auditing came in, I was able to pull that.
You showed, you said you had the invoice, you paid it, this board approved it, and this board has not approved it.
But there's not actually a contract, and the insurance companies make that decision or something, or that's what was said last week today.
There's a legal agreement, it was signed between City of Lee and the county's board. That's the contract issue. And I would just like to add that not only do we have copied that contract, the City of Lee also has copied that contract.
So they were well aware.
The public was well aware, if you want to get right down to it, and believe the newspaper ran in 2011 and informed that that contract had expired, and when we voted to change that agreement, it was not broken.
And, Trent, I think you had a question to the deputy judge, that that line item was still in the budget, correct? This fiscal court, or a fiscal court, approved that budget. I would still have questions from the audience members. Keep it to a question, please. Yes, Derek.
Who signs the check?
I'll turn it over to the deputy judge.
It's a bill signature. It's myself. Obviously, no one can sign in place of myself, but it also requires another signature from the judge's office.
And who would that be?
Excuse me. And Mr. Bashner, you have not brought anything to the court in quite some time. We know why you're here.
I'm here to look. I'm a taxpayer.
Mr. Bashner, this is not a political forum.
Of course it's not, this but I'm not, a taxpayer.
Mr. Bashner, this is not a political forum. And I'm more than happy to meet with you concerning any questions you may have, because you've already been bringing questions to my office. Now, you were the deputy judge at one time, and you chose to quit. So you should be aware of what, of how it functions. Now, you may ask your follow-up question.
Who signed the check?
And you got the answer.
And the treasurer, and did you sign it?
And that, Mr. Rasmus, you got your answer.
I haven't gotten an answer yet. I know the treasurer signed it. Who else signed it?
Deputy Judge, if you want to answer, but again, you're welcome to meet with me at Mr. Asner.
Okay, I'm not trying to be complicated. I just wanted to
know. Mr. Asner, you're welcome to meet with me at any time. Okay. At your
thank you, Judge. Thank you.
Magistrate, you're welcome to meet with me at any time. But we're turning this into a political forum, and that's not what this court is about.
Deb is going about asking a question. He wants to because he is a taxpayer.
Well, thank you, Magistrate.
Oh, let me say that at the next fiscal court meeting, I'll happily, in the next 2 weeks, we will research who signed the checks. If that's what you want me to do. Is that what you want me to do? Since he's asking the question.
That's what that
well, means. I see what's going on here.
But fiscal court, it's all the draft that we signed before we signed. I'm the only person that really knows what we're signing. Quite honestly.
I really had no idea who signed the check, if it was you or if it was me, it had to be one or the other. But all checks were approved before we signed.
All checks are approved by who?
Yes, ma'am.
Again, Dad, I'm more than willing to meet with you. Please,
Thank you.
Come to me.
You made that clear.
Communication is a two-way street.
Indeed it is. And I'd just like to say something for the record if I may.
This is not public comment right now. We're just taking questions. We're taking questions concerning our agenda. Public comment will be at the foot of the meeting. Is it, is this a question?
It is.
Is it about the same topic?
Well, sort of not, but,
okay.
Because I don't even know what the topic was about. And I'm sorry, Ruthie said she's not responsible because she knows her check she's sick. But isn't it fiscal court that's responsible? Because they did send the check.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So there is blame not to be shared.
I'm going for you and I both, you know it?
And for me too. Yes, sir.
All right, you're right. Okay, folks, this is our home. We are to conduct business in this court. Let's be respectful of the process. Let's be respectful of each other. We are Americans. And people have fought for our freedom so that we can sit here today. Yes, Laura, is this a question, Laura?
This is a question. Thank you. What will prevent this from happening again with any contract?
I'll let the magistrates answer that because, again, everything's passed through fiscal court.
This is human error, and you're always going to have some human error no matter what you do. I think Ms. Sharp has done a very decent job all the way through, but, you know, you're still going to have errors no matter what. It's a human error, and that's all you can say.
You know, the group falls in a lot. Take her out of the group.
Okay, excuse me. Okay, hold on just a second. We're going to take it. We're going to take one question at a time.
Either out of the broom closet would help a lot.
Mr. Johnson, yes, hold on just a second, please.
Okay.
Here he has, Mr. Moore had his hand up first. Let's let Mr. Moore speak, and then Mr. Johnson, you can have your question. Remember, folks, this is your court.
I don't think it is.
Mr. Johnson here, he had his hand up first. Yes, here.
Do you have this type of agreement with any other cities in the county?
Ms. Sharp, you were yes. Here before me. Not Washington, D.C.
One more question. Do we know that it's getting ready to expire?
Are you asking me, Lois?
Yes, because we need to know about these types of the errors.
Yes. If you're asking me, go ahead, finish your question and I'll give my answer.
Because of the tax dollars, do you think we need to get a better grasp of where we spend our money, our tax dollars?
Are you ready for an answer now?
Yes.
Okay, my answer is definitely, absolutely, positively yes. And I want to thank these two magistrates for approving a finance officer in the budget last week. I've been asking for a finance officer for 7.5 years, and I am confident that that person will be able to check the books and see these things that have occurred, bring them to the fiscal court's attention. Now, the fiscal court is an elected body. We can choose to take the advice of the county attorney or the finance officer or whoever. We can choose to take that advice, or we can choose to not take that advice and reap what we sow, either way. But yes, ma'am, I definitely think I've asked for 7.5 years for more accountability and better oversight of our hard-to-earn tax dollars. And I'm very grateful that these two magistrates have seen the need in that and have put a finance officer in the budget. I know this will raise the bar in our wonderful home. I love my home. I love Bullock County extremely much. I don't want anybody else to be here. So I'm very happy for this to occur. Yes, Deb, give me a question, please.
What will the financial officer do that you can't do?
We will be talking about that at a later date. You have a follow-up question?
What day?
Excuse me?
What day?
Soon. Extremely soon. Okay. Carl, did you see that motion on the floor? Well, thank you for keeping us on track.
The motion was to request the fund back coming out of 125,000. Yes, you can make a motion.
Okay, we've heard the motion. Thank you for bringing our attention. And any questions or discussion on the motion? And hearing none, Ms. Brandon, you call the roll.
Ms. Axelrod?
Yes.
Ms. Hunt?
Yes.
Ms. Braswell?
Yes.
Ms. Robert?
Yes. And folks in the audience, I want to remind you one more time, because some of you all seem to be not taking this very seriously. This is your court. These are your tax dollars. I don't think our tax dollars are lacking matter. Okay. Yeah,
Mark, we're getting my sign up on sign up sheet.
Yeah, sure.
I
we just have line item 5101, 3150. And in the last budget, we had $35,000 in that line item. Is that what the court wants to put back in that line item this time? That is pay monitoring bills. And we will be receiving that money in from the jail, so we'll be obliged. Because you have to draw back how severe and distinguished this is.
Again, it's not about smoking. It has nothing to do about smoking. It has to do with who makes your law and what's accountable. And I thought the important part of that New York Board of Health decision where they struck down the Board of Health in New York said it echoed our Supreme Court, may have been taken from the language. It says the Board of Health lacked authority to impose the ban, saying policymaking is reserved for legislative bodies. In that case, that was the New York City Council. The opinion, if you read it, actually gives great commendation to the health department on the fact that they are out trying to make sure the public understands the dangers of smoking. I'm a non-smoker, and if I could get everybody in my family to smoke, that'd be great. But I don't think the health department needs to be the person that's enforcing that law. I think these folks right here do, or the city that I live in. That way, as opinions change and time changes, we can change the law. And that was what the Supreme Court even talked about. If you read the decision, it is incredibly thorough. It gives, dedicates several pages to the negative effects of smoking. But it also says at the same time in 1954, when that regulation was written, it was probably written in a smoke-filled room where everybody in America and across the world thought smoking was great, and it was cool, and it was the thing to do. And nobody understood the health effects of it. So what their point was is that your legislative bodies have to be in charge of that, rather than an administrative agency, so you, the people, can ask for changes as they go forward. It is by no means to diminish the health department. They do a fabulous job, but I thought it was rock solid on the side of democracy. That's my two cents. And I wanted to thank Norman Lemmy, who gave, he has been such a mentor to me, but he also put in so much time and direction in this case and laid the foundation for us, and he did pass away, and his son picked up his representation for the city of Mount Washington and doing her. We should be acknowledged.
Thank you, County Attorney, for words well spoken and very important words. It's about our freedom, folks. Not our freedom. And those who have fought for it.
Can we speak to the motion to add to my item number 03-101-315-0335?
So action is requested. A motion is requested. So many.
I'll second.
Yes.
Yes.